There are a ton of great resources out there for ICRPG, but few compare to the Adventure Collection. 20 free adventures all ready to go for you to play at your table. Now, if you're a new GM looking to introduce your friends or learn how to play, there's something for you. If you're an experienced GM wanting to run something a little bit more harrowing, there's something for you. And even though the ICRPG mindset is a DIY approach, having a few of these modules in your back pocket is just a really clever and smart thing to do. It has helped me a ton over the years. And I want to go through each of the adventures and give you some recommendations on them. But before we begin, if this is the first time to the channel, my name is Kane. I've been playing ICRPG for years now. And here we talk about ICRPG and how its DIY approach enables us to play the way that we want to play. Let's start off with a few of the adventures that I would recommend that you look at first. If you pick up the Adventure Collection, which is available on the ICRPG community content site, I'll have a link in the description. It's for free. You can download and start looking through it immediately. To begin, if you've been in the ICRPG community at all, you've probably heard about a few of these adventures already or have played them. If you haven't, highly recommend them. Starting with The Last Flight of the Red Sword. This is probably the most recommended top rite of passage game of all time in ICRPG. It's just legendary in what it is. Essentially, this is an adventure where your characters are in space, they find a derelict ship, they come across, they get on board, and they find out that mysterious things are happening as it orbits this dark star, an evil entity in space. They have to discover what the mystery is going on, face off with some mutant reptoids, and eventually escape with their lives. It's a really harrowing, fun adventure that's really straightforward, really easy to pick up, and it's also recommended a ton because if you're coming from other games like 5e or a lot of more fantasy focus, we recommend starting with something very different, which is like sci-fi, to break out of some of the habits of previous games. And as you introduce them into ICRPG, going with sci-fi at the very beginning seems to work really well at bringing new players on, and it's just a great game to have. The next one is the Doom Vault. This is a classic dungeon. I just finished up my deep dive into the series, but essentially your players are diving into a cultist's lair beneath the city of Norburg as they try to stop this Eldritch ritual as this cultist try to summon their god and kill the kings. And it's very classic fantasy. It's very classic dungeon dive as you work through each room. And so this one is another great one to pick up, especially if you want to challenge your players. It can be a little tough. It can put some really good moral imperative decisions on their plate, but the Doom Vault is an awesome little dungeon to work through. Next up is the Eyes of Set. This one is a desert game, and we all know like RPGs and deserts just go hand in hand. And this particular adventure has you come across the town of Hal, who is suffering because their water has dried up, the well is somehow like contaminated, and people are deciding, do we stay, do we leave? And the heroes show up to help out, and they hear that the source of the water, you can access it just outside of town in these ruins. And so the heroes go off to explore. They find the entrance to this ancient temple dungeon. They find some mummies out there, shamblers. They work through it. They find some traps. They go through this ancient serpent folk, snake folk kind of temple, all to get down to this pyramid to find the evil kind of ancient serpent folk deity or big boss that they have to face off with. And so in the desert with a bunch of traps, a bunch of big bosses, you know, good classic monsters to face off with, Eyes of Set is a really fun game to play and introduce. Again, deserts are awesome when it comes to games. All right, Planet Killer. This is another bit of a legendary one. It's actually a two-parter. Planet Killer is a two-part adventure. The first part is you are on the planet itself and you wake up to find that most of the planet is destroyed. People have been evacuated, or it's been the invading force has our impending victory. They're running rampant. The Imperium is there. And you wake up as the final soldiers in this military base, and you have a mission to get the data that they need, the telemetry data for the spaceship that they have been researching off-world. But What you need to do is go into the next room and get mechs, power suits that you can jump into and run through as you collect the telemetry data, the pod that you need that will be able to send it off into space, as well as the launch space that you need to get to, all while dealing with death drones and these metallic dogs that are running around, as well as the some big bosses there to face off with, all in these power suits. So that's part one. You're trying to do this all before the planet itself explodes. So it's a last-ditch effort for the fate of humanity of this planet. Then the second part is if you can successfully get that off, or whether you don't, the next part is up in space outside of the planet, out in orbit, where you're doing this space fight, this dogfight across your ship, through these jets and space fighters across the gap over to the Imperium ship, where you hope to land and destroy their ship. So you go from power suits on the surface to space fighters crossing into space, dealing with the swarms there and blowing up huge space vessels, all in a two-part adventure. I've run this one with two different groups. First group ran the first one, and if whatever they did impacted the second one, and it's an absolute blast. Or you run it with the same adventurers, and it's just so cool to see the two sides of the same kind of scenario, both on the planet and on the surface, or out in space. So that's Planet Killer. Highly recommend. Again, great little sci-fi adventure. And finally, probably a great, it doesn't seem like it at first, this is a great starter adventure, Orvald's Tower, because it highlights a ton of stuff about that's good about ICRPG. The idea is you don't start at the bottom of the tower, you start at the top. Having faced off with Orvald the Wizard, the beginning moments of the adventure is you killing Orvald, or defeating him, and in his final breaths he summons this maelstrom of magic to destroy the tower and everything in it. And now your objective is to race down the tower and through the different levels in 15 rounds. 15 rounds is all. And if you're still inside at the end of the 15 rounds, toast. And the maelstrom is preventing you from going outside of just like jumping off and just skydiving off the tower. You have to go through it. And this intense time management focus of just barreling through everything is a ton of fun for players to face off with. And there's all sorts of shenanigans that happen in just a few rounds. So, Orvald's Tower. Now, those are the ones that I would recommend that you look at first. If you're new to ICRPG, if you're looking to play, you're looking to master a few of these ones are some of the more complete, more easy to pick up. And so start with those. But once you're ready and you've got some experience under your belt, or if you want to push yourself a little bit as an ICRPG GM or player, try these adventures. Speed Kills. Okay, this is another one focusing on the sci-fi space. You essentially end up on a planet where there's some death races going on, a bunch of racing across the alien planet. It's a great space for chunks and building out vehicles. It's one of the first times you get introduced that when it was in ICRPG Core. But what's cool about this one is eventually it ends up being kind of a bit of a mystery as this mysterious car starts running around and like murdering the local gangs, and you have to figure out what's going on, and just a ton of high speed, high octane action in vehicles and chunks. And so you get to experience chunks and vehicles and these kind of high speed fights or moments in Speed Kills. It can be a little challenging because of that, but it's a great way to push yourself starting out with chunks. So that's Speed Kills. Next up is Beneath the Door. And this is another great example of, we've seen a lot of fantasy sci-fi so far, but Beneath the Door is changing it from sci-fi and fantasy over into the more cosmic horror, eldritch horror, Lovecraftian. It takes a step away from the high-powered fantasy and sci-fi, gonzo-ness that ICRPG has, and has a more low-to-earth take as you get new classes, something more of like the 1920s vibe, professors, the doctors, the investigators, the detective, things like that. More modern approach. As you explore this mansion that seems to be haunted or cursed with this eldritch, the Ardens family, and it's just very Cthulhu, Call of Cthulhu-esque, Eldritch, Lovecraftian. Like, this is a great one, and it shows how easy you can switch genres with ICRPG and still be playing the same game. So definitely worth it, especially if you're playing something pulp or modern. Beneath the Door is a great one to be familiar with. Next up is The Mercury Dale, another great sci-fi adventure. This time you are in space when a strange object collides with your ship, and then some mysterious events start happening, and you want to investigate and explore what is going on. Additionally, you've got some Mykonoid pirates entering into the scene, which are fun to deal with, as well as you get an introduction to the mainframe, a legendary item within the ICRPG community. And overall, like, it's a really fun way to tie in some meta lore into your games through the Mercury Dale. Next up is Into the Sunset. Now, this one is special because it's actually almost a full campaign. This is for Ghost Mountain, the Weird West setting of ICRPG. And so Into the Sunset is this full campaign. As you go into Ghost Mountain, you start learning about what's going on, interacting with the Dire Gang and Buckskin, and all the weirdness that's going on in Ghost Mountain and what you need to get involved in. And it's a little tougher because some of the scenarios are not like full broken out as like scenes. Here's the adventure, here's the summary of it, the important details, but then how do you run it is up to you. But it does walk you through from like arriving at Ghost Mountain all the way up to a final confrontation with Lucifer and the devil to kind of decide the fate of Ghost Mountain. So if you're looking for Weird West, Into the Sunset is a great way to start. Next up is the Red Fang, another great fantasy dungeon for you to explore. This time we're in a dwarven dungeon. And the premise of this one is that, again, you've got some cultists going on after a big baddie kind of died there but has been resummoned and is gathering power, and players need to kind of get down there and stop this big bad from escaping into the world. So another great bit of world building in Alfheim. This is another great opportunity for you to face a big baddie, and depending on how the actions go, can introduce them into the world in your larger campaign, or it can be a great one-shot adventure to like rush through, face the traps, face the horrors of the blood cultists, and see if you can stop Eris and his maniacal plans and his power. So that's Red Fang. Then finally, if you want to push yourself, we have the Relics of Odium. This is a really special adventure because it's both an adventure, but it's also a bit of a mega dungeon. But it also introduces the concept of a battle world, where if you pick up Relics of Odium, there's a big dungeon. There's a big kind of like mech, like, or colossus just like lying the ground, and his body is part of the dungeon, and you get to explore there. And there's a whole kind of like ecosystem of factions that are flaying out. But what's really special about this one as well is it introduced relics, and it's the concept of these special, huge, powerful items that are supercharged with gems that you can find in Odium. And as you pick them up, you can attach them to your different relics, and they give you more power. So it's like giving your items milestones along the way, and so you can end up with this legendary item of like this massive shield or this sword or this bionic arm or this staff. They're great items to kind of become this legendary piece in your game. It does have a bit of a challenge because you're running this dungeon, you're working through this faction, you're working through this world, and you have to turn it kind of into your own adventure. But they've got a lot of tables on what you can face off with. But Relics of Odium is another really fun example of pushing things to the next level with ICRPG. Now, finally, we're at the last few adventures that are included in the adventure collection, and these ones are ones that I would honestly recommend that you hold off on until you have some experience with ICRPG. They become a little bit more complex, they're not as fully fledged out, so there's a lot more space and gaps that you need to fill. And they get a little complex overall, which is not a bad thing. But if you're new to ICRPG, these ones are probably ones you should put on the shelf and study out a little bit later, or work with someone who's a little bit more experienced to polish up. But the first one is Blackbird. And this one is actually a kind of the middle scene of a scenario, of an adventure. It like sets you up. It puts you right in the middle of the action. It sets you up for a climactic conclusion, but the details of it focus primarily on a single encounter scene on the wings of this giant flying vessel. And it's super intense because you get on the wing, there's this robot that's going on there, you're dealing with the propellers that are flowing. Every couple rounds you have to like get into the safe zone, and it's a great tactical experience as you work through all the details and the environmental challenges. It's just so fun for like it the room design side of this is just you know, gets my brain going. But it can be a little challenge because there's a ton of stuff going on and you fill in the gap to kind of fill out your whole adventure. But Blackboard is a ton of fun to look through. Next up is the Hekkun Carapace. This is another great one that you can look at and kind of build into your campaign as well. You essentially have this giant crab giant storming across the countryside, working its way to the ocean, destroying everything in its path. You get orders to stop it. You have to go in, but the only way to stop it is to go inside of the Hekkun Carapace, and then you have to work through its dungeon and the cultists that are there and stop the evil big bad guy. Like, this is a kind of a campaign chapter conclusion starter, whatever, for your adventures. And so it's the scale of this matches the Hekkun as it is. So ton of fun to work on. Next up is Devious Dimensions. This one in particular leans into the advanced magic system that's available in ICRPG Magic Edition. Like this one, if you don't have some good spells in your back pocket, like this is going to be a tough adventure for you. And this is, yeah, it's tough. But having magic users and just a whole slew of spell casters, like this can be a ton of fun because Devious Dimensions is about chasing this superpowered like wizard through, he was on his way to a prison realm or dimension and he escapes, and now you as your characters have to like bounce through different dimensions of like the Runeverse. You end up going through things like the sand realm, where you're trying to chase down a giant titan worm, get on top of it, but the portal is in his mouth, so you have to chase after the guy on the worm and jump in there. You end up going down to hell, where you have to face off with this demon and have some bargainings there. You end up going into like the mirror dimension and the astral planes and working through all of that. It just opens up the Runeverse in such a fun way and lets you go through everything. From fire to always to the splinter, which is a prison realm, and it just exposes the whole Runeverse to the players, and you're expected to keep up as you chase down this player. So it can get intense and complicated as you work through all of that, and you have all the advanced magic system. But Devious Dimension is a great way to just give a huge treat to spellcasters and just lean into that. Crossroads is another adventure that is specifically kind of like a single scene or a single scenario that you can expand out into a full adventure. Essentially, you have these city guards who are experimenting on the population at orders from the evil villain. It's doing strange things to the people, and you have to end up stopping them, and you have this great room design set up as you're working through it. And facing off with saving the NPCs, facing off with the guards, all those fun tropes, but in a really well-designed like room design. So that's Crossroads. Then we have Minotaur Bridge, which is, again, another scene. You are expected to cross this huge chasm, this huge bridge, but on the other side is this super-powered Minotaur, and he's got two big... what are they, ballista type arrow, you know, big weapons that you can shoot across. So it's a really fun room design for players to kind of think through how do they cross without, you know, facing off or being just shot down as they cross across this bridge. There's no railing, so you just walk across, the Minotaur is going to come out, push you over the side. It's a fun tactical challenge, but it's still a single scene that you can build out. into your rooms. Next up, we have the Mire Miners, which is a little encounter on your way to an abbey to explore this kind of these dwarven miners, but you end up facing a bunch of frogkin and working with these dwarven miners. It's a little, I think, a little fun side adventure that can happen. And just rescuing a bunch of really iconic dwarves sounds like a ton of fun. And especially as you introduce your frogkin into your adventure. All right, last two. Hairpin Gate. This is a little encounter where you're facing off in this kind of underground world and facing off with some myconoids or mushroom fungus people, as you have to deal with some of the room archetype tactical approaches to the scene. And then finally, you have Mechs and Myconoids. This is probably one of the tougher ones to run because it's actually not a full adventure. It's a couple tables about how you can have some gnomish mechs. And again, Myconids, these fungus people facing off. But can you just imagine how much fun like a gnomish little mechs can be? And that's the 20 adventures. As you can see, like, it covers the full gamut of what's available for ICRPG, and it does, like, it covers all of it, but there's still so much more to explore. Like, it goes to show that ICRPG can run pretty much anything that you want, and having these in your back pocket is a great way to take advantage of the resources that are available so that you can play more and introduce the game whenever you need.